Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Widowmaker, Book 2, Turnback Creek, by Robert J. Randisi, narrated by Richard Ferrone, and directed by Greta Byram. This book is copyrighted 2004 by Robert J. Randisi. This recording is copyrighted 2005 by Recorded Books. Legendary gunfighter John Locke is back in action. This time, he's been hired to ride shotgun on a fat payroll wagon bound for Turnback Creek, Montana. This is more than a job for Locke. It's a chance to team up with his old riding partner, one-time lawman Dale Cooper. Things don't go as easy as planned, though. And with sidewinders in the shadows waiting to pilfer the loot for themselves, Locke soon learns that the true danger lies closer than he thought. And now, Turnback Creek.
Prologue. Dan Hagen stared down into the Devil's Basin. It was as if God's hand had come down and scooped out a section of the mountain. When it rained, the section filled with water very quickly. Hagen knew of six people who had been caught during storms and drowned there. Since that time, the basin had become off-limits to anyone with knowledge of the mountain. No one had more knowledge of this mountain than Danny Hagen. He'd been traveling over it for more than 50 of his 70 years. In fact, some folks even referred to it as Hagen's Mountain. "There it is, Henrietta," he said, speaking to his mule. "The Devil's Basin. Quickest way over the mountain, and the most dangerous at this time of the year." Hagen took off his battered hat and looked up at the darkening sky. Rain was coming. It would be light at first, showers good only for making traveling messy. The rocks would get wet and slippery. Lower down, the dirt would turn to mud. Water would run off the mountain into Turnback Creek, both the town and the creek itself. Hagen knew he had time to traverse the basin before the storms became so heavy that it filled with water. He had time to get over the mountain and move on. When the time came and the storms and water receded, he would return to his mountain, crossing over once again at the Devil's Basin. But for now, it was time to move on. "Come on, Henrietta," he said, putting his hat back on and pulling on her lead. "Into the basin." The mule refused to move. "Now, now," Hagen said. "Ain't no time to be stubborn, old girl. We gotta go." Still, the mule didn't move. "I know you don't like this, girl," Hagen said. "I don't either, but it's the shortest way." Actually, he did like it. He liked knowing the mountain well enough to know when the basin could or could not be traversed. He thought he was the only man who did know that. "Come on, girl," he said, shaking her lead. "Time to go." This time the mule did move, and the shaggy-looking animal and the disheveled-looking man started into the Devil's Basin. The sky continued to darken, and eventually the misty rain started falling. It was the kind of rain that just lay over everything, rocks, ground, animals, men, making it all wet and, before you knew it, soaking wet. But it didn't roll off the mountain and into the basin. Not just yet. Chapter 1. Ellsworth, Kansas, 1877. John Locke looked out the window of his hotel room and saw his friend, Marshal Dale Cooper, standing in the street, alone. Cooper hesitated in front of his office, took a deep breath, adjusted his gun belt, and then stepped into the street. "This isn't gonna happen," Locke said. He turned, grabbed his gun belt from the bedpost, and left the room, still strapping it on. He wanted to get down to the street before Cooper could get very far. As he came out the front door, almost at a run, he saw his friend walking down the street with a purposeful stride. "Coop!" He hit the street running and caught up to his friend, who turned to look at him as Locke grabbed his arm. His jaw was set, and his eyes were steely. He looked grim. "John," Cooper said, "what are you doing here?" "Same thing you are." "I'm wearing a badge," Cooper said. "I have to be here. It's my job. You don't." "I'm not letting you do this alone, Coop," Locke said. "It's as simple as that." Cooper stared at his friend, then took a deputy's badge from his pocket and held it out. "No," Locke said, holding up his hand. "Let's just do it." Cooper put the badge away and shook his head. "I'm getting too old for this, John." "You're not even 50 yet." "I'm 48. "See? 48 seem a good age to die to you." "I'm 41, Dale," Locke said, "and that doesn't seem a good age to die." "At the other end of this street are gonna be 5 cowboys," Cooper said. "They're all gonna be wearing guns. Do you know what that means?" "Yes," Locke said. "It means they're cowboys wearing guns when they're more used to holding a lariat. It means that when we reach them, they will officially be outnumbered." Cooper thought that over, then nodded and said, "That's one way of looking at it." Locke slapped the lawman on the back and said, "That's the only way to look at it, my friend." Turnback Creek, Montana. As John Locke rode into the mining town of Turnback Creek, Montana, he realized it had been more than 10 years since he had last seen Dale Cooper. That debacle in Ellsworth with the cowboys. It had cost Cooper his job as marshal, and after that, Locke had pretty much lost track of his friend. If he had taken to wearing a badge somewhere else, Locke had never heard about it. Then, out of the blue, last week, Locke received a telegram in Las Vegas, New Mexico, from Cooper, asking him to meet him in Turnback Creek. Their friendship was such that, even after all the years of silence, Locke left immediately. The town looked fairly typical. Ramshackle buildings, badly rutted streets filled with water after several days of unrelenting rain. It was falling now, the rain, in a misty drizzle. Locke's shirt and jeans were soaked, his leather vest wet. He wanted some dry clothes and a hot meal even before he tried to find Dale Cooper. The telegram had been cryptic, just a line asking Locke to meet him. Didn't say where he was staying or where to find him, but locating Cooper was going to have to wait until he got situated and dry. He came to a hotel before he came to a livery, so he stopped to get a room. "Do you know a man named Cooper?" he asked the clerk as he signed the register. "Dale Cooper." "Dale Cooper?" the young man repeated thoughtfully. "Can't say I do, sir." Before returning the register book to the clerk, Locke checked the last few pages to see if Cooper had checked in, and the clerk simply had forgotten the name. Not only had he not, but no one had. "Room 5, the clerk said. "Top of the stairs and turn right. Do you have a bag?" "I'm going to take my horse to the livery stable," Locke said, accepting the key. "I'll look at the room when I come back. No, no bag. I'll just have my saddlebags." "Yes, sir." Locke turned to leave, then turned back. "Not a very busy time here, is it?"
"It never is, sir," the clerk said. "All we have is the mine, and most of the miners live elsewhere. Right now, there's only 2 other people staying in the hotel."
"Okay," Locke said. "Now, if you'll just tell me where the livery stable is, I'd be obliged." Following the clerk's directions, Locke rode to the livery stable and left his horse in the care of an old man he suspected got along better with horses than with men. He got little more than a grunt from the man, but felt confident leaving his animal with him. He walked back to the hotel, carrying his rifle and saddlebags, looking the town over along the way. It was quiet and probably would stay that way until the miners got off work and started hitting the saloons. "Get your horse taken care of, all right?" the clerk asked as he re-entered the hotel. "Just fine," Locke said. "That's room 5. Locke showed the clerk the key. "I remember." He went up the stairs, found his room, and let himself in. He locked the door behind him, tossed the saddlebags onto the bed, and leaned the rifle against the wall. The room was small, but remarkably clean for a mining town hotel. He'd stayed in much worse places, in better towns. He went to the window and looked down at the street. As he removed his wet shirt, he wondered where Dale Cooper was, or if he was even in town yet, and what had he been doing for the past 10 years. He decided that his jeans weren't all that wet after all, especially since he was going to go back out into the drizzle. He took a clean shirt from his saddlebags and put it on, then used the wet one to wipe down his vest before donning that again as well. The black, flat-brimmed hat he wore was no worse the wear for the rain. He would have to clean his gun, though, when he came back to the room for the evening. For now, he removed it from his holster and wiped it down, too, with the shirt. He savored for a moment the way his fingers fit into the specially made grooves in the handle, then holstered it again, made sure it sat just right. Before leaving the room, he utilized the wet, already dirty shirt for one last task, to wipe down his rifle, which he left behind as he went in search of a nice hot meal. Once again, it was directions from the clerk that got him where he wanted to go. It was a small cafe several blocks from the hotel, and as he approached, he could smell the cooking odors. Keeping to the boardwalk, he was able to avoid getting too wet again, which ensured that he'd be reasonably comfortable when he sat down to his meal. He entered the cafe, which was small but had a homey feel to it. There was only one other table taken at the moment by a man and a woman who didn't give him a second look. "Can I help you?" a waiter asked. "You can, if that's coffee I smell." "It is," the man said. "And good coffee, too." "Then I'll take a table, a cup, and a thick steak." "Sit anywhere you like, sir," the waiter said. "I'll fetch it for you right away." "Thanks." Locke sat away from the middle-aged couple and away from the front window. In a few moments, the waiter returned with not only a cup, but a pot of coffee to go with it. "You look like you've been riding a while," he said. "So I brung you a whole pot." "Thanks," Locke said. He poured himself a cup of coffee and stole a glance at the couple. They seemed intent on their meal and weren't talking to each other. The man looked to be in his early 50s, but the woman was younger than he'd first thought when he'd pegged them as a middle-aged couple. She appeared to be in her mid-30s, a handsome woman with pale skin and long dark hair worn behind her head in a bun. When the waiter came out with a steak dinner, Locke lost interest in the couple and applied himself to the hunk of beef and the steaming vegetables. He hadn't eaten this well in quite a while, and he became thoroughly engrossed in the meal. He was finishing up when the couple called for their check, paid it, and stood up to leave. He was surprised when the woman stopped and spoke to him as they passed his table. The man stopped with her, stood just behind her right shoulder.
"I haven't seen a man eat quite that fast in a long time," she said, gracing him with a smile that transformed her from merely handsome to quite beautiful.
"It's been a while since I had a meal this good, ma'am," he said. "I hope my eating habits didn't offend you."
"Molly," the man with her said.
"Wait for me outside, George," she said.
The man looked as if he wanted to say something else, but he abruptly turned and left. Locke wondered if they were married or if the man merely worked for her. Either situation could have explained the couple's apparent relationship.
I wasn't offended at all,
she said, continuing from where they'd left off. Locke wondered what he'd done to invite this attention. As attractive as she was, there was still some food on his plate that he wanted to get to before it cooled off.
In fact, it's nice to meet a man with an appetite and manners, she said. Do you mind if I sit a moment?
Surprised again, he said, Go ahead.
Thank you.
She sat opposite him. He could see the man waiting impatiently right outside the door.
Have you just arrived in town?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I'm over at the Shillstone Mining Office, she said. You look like a man who might be looking for work. I need a man who's confident and knows what he's doing with a gun.
What makes you think I'm that man?
Just a hunch.
She leaned her elbows on the table and set her chin in her palm.
I usually go with my hunches.
Well, I'm not looking for work, ma'am, Locke said, but I'll keep that in mind.
You do that, Mr.
Locke, he said. John Locke. Her face froze for a moment, but then she smiled and said,
A pleasure to have met you, Mr. Locke.
Ma'am. As she went out the door and he returned to his food, the waiter came over with a fresh pot of coffee. That was Molly Shillstone, he said. Locke looked up at the waiter. So I gathered. Owns the biggest mine hereabouts, the waiter said. You can leave the coffee, Locke said, not wanting any more interruptions, and bring me some more vegetables. You want another hunk of beef with those vegetables? The man asked. Got it hot and ready. Locke thought only a moment and said, Hell, why not? Chapter 2. Since the place was empty and the waiter had thrown the second hunk of beef in for free, Locke decided to go ahead and talk to the man. Well, actually, he let the man go ahead and talk to him, which he did from the seat right across from him. The gold played out a long time ago, the man said. But Mrs. Shillstone's mine has a lot of other metals in it. His name was Felix, and on days like this, when it wasn't busy, he was both the cook and the waiter, but he wasn't the owner of the place. Locke had already gotten much more information about Felix than he wanted, but he didn't want to insult the man who very well might have been the only good cook in town. Like what other metals? Locke asked. I'm not sure, Felix said, but there's a lot of them, and a lot of uses for them. Locke knew that some gold mines would also yield other ores, as well as some stones, such as diamonds. Any diamonds? Diamonds? Felix frowned. I don't think so. Locke pushed away the empty plate and poured himself another cup of coffee to wash both meals down. Actually, what he needed now was a cold beer, but he had a question or two for Felix before he left and went in search of a saloon. Felix, tell me, what did I do today to attract Mrs. Shillstone's attention? He asked. Well, Felix said, a couple of things. One, you're a stranger. What's that got to do with anything? You ain't had time to take sides yet. Locke was going to ask what sides, but he knew that in any town there were sides, usually two, sometimes more. What else? You look like you can handle a gun. Why would she need someone who can handle a gun? Payroll. What about it? She's had one hit and doesn't want it to happen again. Someone robbed her payroll? Felix nodded. They hit it when it was on its way up the mountain, Felix said. Her men ain't been paid in months, and they're about to quit on her. So she's got another payroll coming in? Yep, Felix said. End of the week, and she's gonna need somebody to deliver it up the mountain. Locke sat back in his chair. How much are we talking about? Well, the first one was more than $10,000, Now, since the men ain't been paid in a while, they want more than they got coming, so this one figures to be about 5 times that.
$50,000?
Maybe more. How do you know that?
Locke was wondering how a waiter knew so much about the woman's business.
Hell, the whole town knows her business, Felix said. After all, a lot of the businesses in town depend on the miners having money to spend, and she's got the biggest mine and the most miners. Hell, it's everybody's business now, not just hers.
So with everybody knowing how much she's bringing in,
it's a sure bet this payroll's gonna be hit as well, Felix finished. She needs somebody who can handle a gun to take it up there, and now she knows who you are.
Locke didn't rise to that bait.
I mean, are you really John Locke, the Widowmaker?
I'm John Locke, he replied. I don't know how many John Locks there are, though.
Well, Felix said, if you're him, you, that is, she's definitely gonna want you to work for her. Probably pay you a pretty penny, too. If she loses another payroll, she's in lots of trouble, and so is this town.
So what do you mean about taking sides?
She's not a well-liked woman, is all, Felix said. There are them who feel the town could survive without her, but they ain't in the majority, I can tell you that.
Well, Locke said, it's too bad I'm not looking for a job. What do I owe you?
75 cents.
Locke gave the man a silver dollar and stood up. Who is that man with her? Locke asked, out of curiosity. She called him George.
That's George Crowell.
Husband?
No, he's her manager, Felix said. Or foreman. I ain't sure what she calls him.
Looks like she runs pretty roughshod over him.
That she does, Felix said. And he lets her, because he's in love with her.
And the whole town knows that, too?
Yep.
When they reached the door, Felix said,
Actually, Molly, that's Mrs. Shillstone, but everybody in town just calls her Molly, did hire somebody to take the payroll up the mountain.
She did? Locke asked. Then why would she be looking to hire me to do the same thing?
Well, Felix said, she ain't all that sure she hired the right man for the job.
And why is that?
Well, he's been sitting around waiting for the payroll to get to Kingdom Junction. That's where the railhead is.
He's been waiting here or there?
Oh, here.
So what's wrong with that? Locke asked. What else has the man got to do but wait?
I think she's worried about where he's doing his waiting.
And where's that?
The saloon.
Drinking?
Oh, yeah.
Felix said with a nod.
Supposed to be some big-time ex-lawman, too.
Locke stopped in his tracks, almost out the door. And what would his name be?
His name's Marshall Cooper, Felix said. Dale Cooper. Ever heard of him?
Chapter 3. There were 3 saloons in Turnback Creek. According to Felix the waiter, Dale Cooper spent his days in the largest of the 3. When he walked into the 3 Aces saloon, he spotted Cooper right away. He was sitting at a back table with his head down on it, one hand wrapped around a whiskey bottle. Locke decided not to approach his old friend right away, and instead went to the bar to get himself that beer. There were only 3 other men in the place, all of them standing at the bar. Beer. Locke said to the bartender, who was deep in conversation with 2 of the men.
Coming right up,
the barman said, but he did not go for the beer right away.
I'd like it now,
Locke said. The bartender, a young man in his 30s, turned his head and looked at Locke.
I'll get it in a minute, old-timer, the man said. I'm finishing up a conversation here.
Locke reached across the bar and closed his left hand over the man's forearm.
No, Locke said.
You're getting me a beer, and then you can go back to your conversation.
The bartender straightened up, and the two men he'd been talking to turned to face Locke, who stared back at the bartender while keeping the other two men in his peripheral vision. It was a tense moment, and Locke wondered if they valued their conversation enough to go for their guns, but the decision was made for all of them by the other man in the room.
"Get him his beer, Al," the man said, "and stop being such an asshole."
The man was standing at the far end of the bar, and Al, the bartender, turned to look at him.
"Do it," the man said wearily.
"Yeah, okay, Mike," the bartender said.
He drew a beer, and as he went to set the mug down, Locke said,
"Don't spill it."
The man hesitated, then set the mug down gently and moved away to stand near his friends. Locke lifted the beer and gestured to the man at the end of the bar, who lifted his own beer in return and then straightened up and started toward Locke. The badge on his chest was in plain view now, and as he reached Locke, the word sheriff became clear.
"Much obliged, sheriff," Locke said.
"John Locke, isn't it?" the man asked.
Locke hesitated long enough to study the man. He was 40 or so, about 6 foot, heavy through the shoulders and chest, thick in the waist. Not a man to go hand to hand with. The gun on his hip was worn, but cared for.
"Do I know you, sheriff?"
"No,"
the lawman said. "But I know you. I saw you once, a few years ago. In Laramie, I think."
"I've been in Laramie."
Locke looked over at Cooper, who hadn't moved. He identified his friend from the bald spot on the crown of his head, which had spread but was still recognizable. It had been a sore spot with Cooper when he was in his 40s. Apparently, now that he was almost 60, it didn't matter much to him, for his hat was on the floor next to him.
"My name is Mike Hammett," the lawman said. "Been sheriff here about 2 years."
"Good for you."
"Not really," Hammett said, "but it's a job. And as part of my job, I've got to ask you what brings you to Turnback Creek."
Locke looked away from Cooper at the lawman.
"I'm here to meet someone."
"Who?"
"A friend."
"Anybody I'd know?"
"Maybe."
The lawman remained silent and waited. Locke gave him some credit for that.
"Dale Cooper."
Hammett looked over at the slumped man.
"Yeah, that's him," Locke said.
"I didn't know," Hammett said. "Marshal Dale Cooper."
"That's right."
"He's not wearing a badge now."
"Apparently not."
"Friend of yours?"
"Yes," Locke said. "For a long time."
"He's not in very good shape," Hammett said. "Been here a few days. Spends every day in here. What brought him here?"
"A job, I think."
"Working for who?"
the lawman asked, then answered his own question.
"Wait a minute. He ain't the one Molly Shillstone hired to transport her payroll, is he?"
"I don't know, sheriff," Locke said. "I won't know what the job is until I talk to him."
"You'll have to wake him up first," Hammett said. "Sober him up. Either one might be hard to do, I guess."
Hammett's beer mug was almost empty. He set it down on the bar and said,
"Good luck."
"Yeah," Locke said.
"Thanks."
He carried his beer with him to Dale Cooper's table. Sheriff Mike Hammett watched as Locke walked over to the table the older man was slumped on. He hadn't known he had a man with a reputation like Dale Cooper's in town, and now he had two men with reputations in Turnback Creek. He was going to have to keep an eye on them.
"Hey, Sheriff."
Hammett turned and looked at the bartender, whose voice was a whisper in his ear.
"What?"
"Is that really him?"
"Who?"
"The Widowmaker," Al said. "I'm asking, is that really John Locke, the Widowmaker?"
"I guess it is," Hammett said.
"They say nobody knows which one the Widowmaker is," Al said. Him or the gun?
So?
Do you know the answer?
Hammett turned and looked at the bartender.
What's it matter, Al? He asked. Either way, you're just as dead, ain't you?
The bartender was thinking about that as the sheriff walked out the door. Chapter 4. Locke walked to the table, put his beer down, and sat across from Dale Cooper. This close, he could see his friend clearly. He looked bad, old. His skin was more weathered than he'd ever seen it. His hair, what there was of it, wispy and gray. He reached over and removed the whiskey bottle from his friend's clutch, and it was a strong clutch. He had to pull a couple of times to get it away from him. It wasn't until he freed the bottle from Cooper's hand that the man stirred, lifted his head, and looked across the table at him, bleary-eyed.
"That you, John?"
Cooper rasped. "It's me, Dale." Cooper groaned and pushed himself up from the table to an upright position.
"I need a drink," he said.
"Think so?"
"To clear my throat."
Locke hesitated, then pushed his beer mug across to his friend. Cooper hesitated for just a moment, picked it up, and took a healthy swallow. When he was done, he cleared his throat some more, loudly, and pushed the mug back to Locke. He could smell his friend's foul scent from across the table, whiskey-soaked sweat coming out of his pores. "Did you ask me to meet you here to see you like this, old friend?" Locke asked. Cooper cleared his throat one more time, a harsh growl, and then said,
"No."
He rubbed both hands vigorously over his face.
"Christ, John, I need a drink."
"You need some coffee," Locke said. "Some food and a bath, and not in that order."
"A drink first."
"If you take a drink before you do any of those things," Locke said, "I'm gonna saddle up and ride out."
"No, no," Cooper said. "Wait. I need you for a job."
"I don't want to hear it, Dale."
"What?"
"I don't want to hear another word until you're cleaned up and sober," Locke said. "You got any other clothes?"
No other clothes,"
the older man said. "A place to stay?"
I'm staying at a rooming house."
"Been there in a while?"
Not since last night, I think."
"Okay," Locke said. "We're going over to my hotel and get you cleaned up, and I mean a bath. Then we'll go to the general store and I'll buy you some clothes."
"I've got money,"
Cooper said, sounding almost indignant. Locke stood, walked around the table, and took his friend's arm. He helped him to his feet that way, noticing at the same time that Cooper was wearing a gun. It wasn't much of a gun, an old Navy Colt, but it was a gun. He bent down to retrieve Cooper's hat and slapped it down on his head. "Let's go, Dale," he said, starting for the door. Abruptly, Cooper pulled his arm away, staggered, and almost fell, but he kept to his feet.
"I can walk."
Locke heard some laughter from the other men, but when he looked over at them, they stopped and looked away.
"Then walk, damn it," he said. "I didn't come all this way to find out you're a washed-up old drunk."
"Old drunk," Cooper muttered. "I'll show you who's an old drunk. Got a job for us. A good one. Good pay."
"I hear from you after 10 years of silence because you got a job for us?" Locke asked.
"I need you, John," Cooper said. "I can't do it alone. I need you."
"Fine, Dale," Locke said. "Let's get you that bath and those clothes, and we'll talk about it over a cup of coffee."
"Okay," Cooper said. "Okay. But I can walk."
"Sure you can," Locke said, and took his arm again.
Chapter 5. When Dale Cooper was bathed, dressed in new clean clothes, and reasonably sober, Locke took him to the small cafe where he'd first met Molly Shillstone.
"Hungry already?" Felix asked.
"My friend could use some coffee," Locke told him, "and I didn't have dessert."
"Pie?"
"Apple," Locke said with a nod. "When's the last time you ate something, Dale?"
"I don't remember."
"Bring 2 slices," Locke told the waiter.
"Gotcha."
Several tables were occupied, but Locke was able to grab the same table he'd had earlier in the day. Cooper was morose as Locke seated him and then sat across from him.
"You're not making me feel very good about coming all this way to see you, Dale," Locke said.
"I dropped what I was doing, even though your telegram said very little, in the name of our friendship. Tell me if you're a hopeless drunk and I'm wasting my time here."
After a moment, Cooper looked across the table at Locke and said,
"I'm not hopeless."
"So you're a drunk," Cooper said.
"My life hasn't been easy since we last saw each other, John."
"And that's why you're a drunk?" Cooper waited a moment, then said,
"I don't remember you being such a harsh judge."
Felix came over with the coffee and pie, saw that something was going on between the two men, and withdrew without saying a word.
"John,"
Cooper said.
"Yes, I'm a drunk, or I have been, but I'm trying to quit."
"Didn't look that way to me today, Dale. Looked to me like you spent a few days inside a bottle."
"Don't tell me you've never gotten drunk."
Locke had his own problems with drinking, which had cost him his one and only job as a lawman in Tombstone years ago, but that wasn't the point. Of course, it had something to do with his being so judgmental when it came to others.
"All right, Dale," Locke said. "The past 10 years have been hard on you. So hard that you disappeared from sight. I assume it all stems from that day in Ellsworth."
"That wasn't my fault," Cooper said.
"You were the marshal," Locke said. "Your fault or not, you took the blame."
Much the same thing had happened to Locke in Tombstone, only to a certain extent, that was his fault. He wasn't willing to discuss that with Cooper, though.
"That was part of the job."
"It wasn't fair,"
Cooper muttered.
"Eat some pie," Locke said.
"I can't eat."
"Drink some coffee."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.